He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing.
Hello, friends. This is the Lector Preparation for September 16th, 2018, the 24th. Sunday in Ordinary Time. I'm in the Lector Preparation book and on page 255, reading a commentary at the bottom about the reading from Isaiah. Although this prophecy could also be applied to an individual's experience, the servant named here is often interpreted as the community of ancient Israel. In that sense, the reading is an expression of the community's understanding of its situation before God. The first part describes the suffering endured in obedient docility, sufferings the servant has accepted without complaint. Are the people responsible for their unhappy history due to their sins, or are they victims? The preceding verses have spoken of sin and transgression, but here the servant is innocent. The servant has not hidden his face, even though the exposure subjected him to shame and spitting. In the midst of insult, the servant is confident in the Lord's help, even though the prophet does not specify how it will take place. The last part of the reading stresses the servant's fortitude. Silent suffering is not a sign of cowardice. God strengthens him in the face of tormentors. In the end, only the servant will continue, while his adversaries will be eclipsed. Christians read this prophecy as fulfilled in Jesus, silently enduring his passion. It may also be seen as a picture of the church in the present age. So some of the notes to the left to help us in preparing. So this is an exhortatory reading, and it suggests that we maintain a steadfast calm and confidence throughout. Stand up straight, keep eye contact with the assembly. The pronunciation of the word Isaiah, I think that's pretty well known, but it's worth noting. And the prophet names the source of his strength right away, that God is what he's all about. When you get to the point where it says, I have given my back to those who beat me, my cheeks, etc., it asks us to be careful not to sound weary or put out. So, in other words, you would say, I've given my back to those who beat me. You know, that's where you don't want to go. You want to say it with confidence. I have given my back to those who beat me, to my cheeks, to those who plucked my beard. I have a beard right now. It's hard to imagine someone pulling it all out. It doesn't sound like a good time. Further on down, then, when there's a shift, it says, smile as you recall your relationship with God. Because you've been recalling all these terrible things that have happened to you, you want to shift. And he said, even though that has all happened, the Lord God is my help. And then pause at the end of the line where it says, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. Okay, so then we get to the bottom part here, and in this part, if the suggestion is to have an attitude like, I am ready to meet anyone who questions if God loves me. If anyone wishes to oppose me, let us appear together. I'm ready. You know, bring it on. I'm ready for it. And then don't challenge, rather maintain a centered confidence. Again, it matters how you ask the question. Who disputes my right? That would be a challenge. But if you're going to maintain a confidence, you might say, who disputes my right? Let that person confront me. Again, I'm ready for it. I can handle it. And finally, at the end, I like this line. It says, offer your assembly that same relationship with God. You know, you almost want to face them, and as if you were just saying to them one-on-one, see, the Lord God is my help. Who will prove me wrong? Okay, so here's the reading. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God opens my ear that I may hear. I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help. Therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The Lord is near who upholds my right. If anyone wishes to oppose me, let us appear together. Who disputes my right? Let that man confront me. See, the Lord God is my help. Who will prove me wrong? The word of the Lord. So we'll move on to the next reading, and we're continuing in the letter to St. James. I find James's writing refreshing in a way. So many times we have Paul, and I love Paul, but James just has a different approach, and I really appreciate that. The commentary again on page 255, Paul wrote that the person is not justified primarily by the works of the law, but by faith and adherence to Jesus. Here, James writes that a person is not justified by faith alone. Does this present teaching contradict that of Paul? Paul's works refer to the detailed descriptions of the Mosaic law. He holds that a person has to fulfill more than outward observance. James's point is clear. Ideological faith, insufficient in itself, must be translated into action. Needy persons are not aided simply by the good wishes of their followers. The faith commitment is to be translated into practice. Paul argues against those who claim to gain salvation just on the basis of their good deeds, but he understands how true faith leads to a generous life. In this reading, James condenses the key idea. Faith without works is dead. It cannot save. His example is similar to the reading in John. If someone who has worldly means sees a brother in need and refuses him compensation, how can the love of God remain in him? For James, deeds authenticate the Christian life and give evidence of the truth of faith and charity. Notes to the left also. This is also a didactic reading, and don't get caught up in the theology here. The teaching is very simple. Keep your proclamation the same. The tone throughout is, don't you see? Don't you see how good it is? Don't you see if someone has faith but does not have works, how can that faith save him? Don't you see if you say to him, go in peace? Don't you see that? When he goes to that line of go in peace, he is suggesting that we don't mock him. We don't say, go in peace, keep warm, eat well, as if you're being a hypocrite. I think he's saying that be sincere. I mean, he's not questioning that the genuineness of their faith, but just that it hasn't been put into action. The next line, slow a bit and set this line apart. This is the kernel of the whole reading. So make sure you slow it down, you very much articulate, you really practice how you want to say that, because you could skip the whole reading and just say that, and it wouldn't be good enough, but it would encapsulate everything. Finally, in the last line, it says, demonstrate your faith to me without works, and I will demonstrate my faith to you from my works. And it asks you to emphasize from. So the way you can emphasize will be, as I did, you know, I stressed the word, but I also put a little bit of a break before and after, and that tends to emphasize it. A reading from the letter of St. James. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone says he hath faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister has nothing to wear and has no food for the day, when one of you says to them, "Go in peace, keep warm, and eat well," but you do not give him the necessities of the body, what good is it? So also faith of itself, if it does not have works, is dead. Indeed, someone might say, "You have faith and I have works." Demonstrate your faith to me without works, and I will demonstrate my faith to you from my works. The word of the Lord. The gospel today, Jesus has given sight to a blind person last week in the reading. Now he will open the eyes of his disciples, a process that spans the following chapters on the road to Jerusalem. This episode, when the disciples confess Jesus as the Messiah, is the turning point in his ministry. Popular opinion regards him as a prophet with a stature like that of Elijah, the forerunner of the Messiah. But the disciples confessed him to be the Messiah. Toward the end of Old Testament times, the Messiah was expected to appear as a victorious figure with no hint of defeat or suffering. Jesus now removes any false messianic impressions, explaining that the Messiah will undergo suffering and death. Peter, acting as spokesperson, rebukes Jesus for speaking about such apparent defeat. Jesus' reply is forceful. The plan of salvation requires that the Messiah suffer. Peter, in the role of tempter, represents the limited human viewpoint. Now Jesus confronts the disciple with the paradox of discipleship. The one who undergoes humiliation is exalted. The one who offers his or her life will be saved. Jesus instructs the disciples to embrace the cross, accept the challenge of self-giving, and renounce the desire to preserve and enrich one's own existence at any cost. Jesus understands his mission as Messiah from God's perspective, and thus the prediction of his passion, death, and resurrection. From this point on, Jesus will concentrate on the disciples' formation. Three passion predictions identify him as the suffering servant of Isaiah and demonstrate the necessity of the passion and death to enter into glory. After the first prediction, Jesus challenges believers to true commitment to him through the renunciation of self and acceptance of suffering, even to the sacrifice of life itself. Whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life will save it, expresses the paradox of life and contrasting density. Life is understood as centered on earthly existence and lived in denial of Christ, an existence that ends in destruction. When lived in union with Christ, despite earthly death, life achieves true and lasting value. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus and his disciples set out for the villages of Caesarea Philippi. Along the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say that I am?" They said in reply, "John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others one of the prophets." And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter said to him in reply, "You are the Christ." Then he warned them not to tell anyone about him. He began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer greatly and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and rise after 3 days. He spoke this openly. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. At this he turned around and looked at his disciples, rebuked Peter, and said, "Get behind me, Satan. You are thinking not as God does, but as human beings do." He summoned the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "Whoever wishes to come after me must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and that of the gospel will save it." the gospel of the Lord. Thank you all very much, and God bless you. Look forward to hearing your wonderful presentations this Saturday and Sunday. God bless you.